It's 12 o'clock on a Wednesday and this is the Wizard Magic Review. I'm Dave.
I'm Paul.
I'm Wayne.
And on this week's show we've got plenty of reviews, but I want to apologise that there wasn't a show last week. It's been 3 weeks since our last confession. Show. It was one of those weeks, you know, where you go to the magic circle and people go, are you busy? Are you busy? And it was one of those weeks where somebody says that and you go, hold my beer.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
It was like literally a crazy week last week. Thanks to Paul Martin, we did a job, a few of us.
That looked great.
Magicians for the Royal Polo with William and Kate. There was the British Grand Prix for Ferrari. And
three names dropped.
You know, corporate clients and private parties. And you know, it was a crazy week. Something on every single day. The Royal Polo was the highlight. So thanks for that, Paul Martin.
I did some kids' gigs. They were great.
Kids' parties.
I did a 50th last night for an Indian fan. It was amazing.
Well, at least I haven't come just as a postman.
Right, yeah, okay.
Is my parcel ready yet, Dave?
Wayne said, have I come in fancy dress today? I've come as a UPS delivery man.
It is. That's quite
funny. And it's an interesting comment. And with that, the comments leads on to the YouTube comments, because as Sean pointed out, we do read the YouTube comments.
We do.
The best one, the winner for me last week was somebody that said, every time I see Dave Penn, I think of the banana splits. I don't know what you're talking about. And you said it was Smiler.
I think it's Smiler. Where's his massive glasses?
We'll put a comparison picture up.
My little sticky up hair gets some comments.
Yeah, your hair is getting lots of comments now. In fact, your hair's probably got its own Facebook page.
Listen, mate,
right,
you have
now.
Got gorgeous hair. Think yourself lucky.
Your ball.
I haven't had any since I was about 4 years old.
I don't want to show off.
Right, first up, the review. Did you see, it was your hair. Someone said, good to see you back on the show before last.
Bless your hearts, thank you. I have been tearing around.
And I tried to reignite the Android versus Apple debate, just to wind you up.
What's the point? Doesn't wind me up. Well, we've won, I get it. Android win, the fact that you're trying.
Right, so first review this week is Comet Wallet by Andrew Dean. So this is a unique design of a wallet, but before we mention the wallet, should we have a demonstration?
Why not? Damn it.
By Wayne Fox, MIMC. Have you got the gold star, Wayne?
I have got the gold star.
Yeah, of course.
What's the matter with you?
Wayne Fox, AIMC with gold star. Make sure you're on the close-up camera as well.
They're all different.
I haven't seen them all.
Okay, I'm going to spread these out. And Paul,
Wayne,
slide one card out, mate.
That one there, thank
you. And turn it face up. And you're going to put a signature across there as well. Really big and bold,
right,
so everyone
camera,
can see
but
it.
I'll go. There we go. Like
thank you.
There we go. Got the handheld camera now.
Look how honest I've been.
There we go.
All right.
All right, I'm coming back to this shot.
Shall I recap? You recap, mate.
Well,
if you
listen, spread the cards.
I'll set them up. You knock them down.
Hang on. There's your camera. It's your close-up.
Careful.
There we go.
Right. Dear. I was getting worried. I need you to shuffle these and mix them
okay.
up.
Okay.
That's all right, yeah?
Of course.
Go for it.
I thought you were doing a 10-minute routine before you went into it.
Okay. You haven't seen the rest of it yet. Just hang on. Just hold your horses.
Shuffling the cards.
All right. I consider those shuffled.
Right.
Happy? You signed it, you shuffled it, you put them in there. In my pocket.
Yeah.
A wallet.
Right.
And in my wallet.
Can we see this on camera, Wayne? Can we bring it towards the camera?
There's the smallest, tightest, sealed up, tiny envelope.
Yeah.
Can you just tear it open from the end?
This end.
That's it, go on.
Oh, on camera.
Yeah.
Oh, and yet you shuffled that pack.
I did shuffle a pack.
You signed a card and put it in there. It's been in your hand the whole time. And that is well sealed, isn't it?
That's really well sealed. That was... No.
Folding in half, your signed card.
Oh!
Has anybody got any questions?
Come on. There we go. So that was a demonstration of basically like the end of a card routine.
It really is, yeah.
Normally you do a bit more, give a bit more value for
you
money.
You would put in there a lot of ambitious stuff. And yeah. You wouldn't just do that one thing with it.
But we are reviewing the Comet wallet. Now, Andrew Dean has basically created this sort of modern style of wallet. I did have mine somewhere as well, which I put some business, because you can put your business cards in here as well.
Yeah.
And this acts kind of like as a peak if you want to. So that's another feature of the wallet, is that you can use it like a peak. And he suggests like a choreography where you just go to them like this, just look at me, and in this action you can peek what's on the other side of a business card, which is kind of cool. He's also got a full card to wallet. So yeah, you folded it in half once, which is what Andrew actually suggests.
Mm-hmm.
We were talking earlier about the fact you can actually Mercury card fold it
you can
if you
do,
want
yeah.
to. And
ideally, I would do. I would.
Because we were talking. Like it's more important. Magicians go, oh yeah, it's a Mercury card, fold the card. But to a spectator, yes, that is another layer of impossibility. Mm. The fact that it's folded again. But you did it the way Andrew describes it.
Yeah.
And he's got a couple of different versions. One which is the folded card straight into the wallet. So when it goes straight into the wallet, it comes out of this area, just here. So if you wanted to use this as your everyday wallet, you can open this up and the folded card is in this side of the wallet, along with your business cards, just here. You did it with
the envelopes.
The envelope.
Yeah.
The interesting thing with the envelope is you don't need to buy replacement envelopes.
You don't. You want a PDF.
Andrew has supplied you with a PDF, and he goes through the bulk of the instructions, and it's only 22 minutes or so. He's actually describing how to make the envelopes, and sort of personalize them if you want to. So you could print your own envelopes on just a piece of white paper, cut them out and prepare them yourself using
them
the glue that's
on there as well. Yeah, it's
and it uses the Harry Robson instant reset.
Yeah, it does, yeah.
Which means that it can be instantly reset. But another feature of this wallet as well, and I can get some cards out to demonstrate this, is that you can put your business cards in here like this. You're laughing at
me. I'm laughing because I can see business what
you're
doing.
Here we go. Here just we go. Here like this. And this area also that pops out and sort of staggers the cards, you can load a folded card between here well if you want to. But it's quite nice that it's got this modern part to the wallet here. It is a very modern design. The only thing with it is, unless you sort of have a small bill folded up and tuck it in there, it doesn't take any bills, really.
Mm-hmm.
You could put bills in the little pockets, like an emergency 20 or something like that, if you want to. But it really is a modern wallet that's only sort of cashless, using your cards.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that it's got that bill to, the envelope feature, so it can go card to wallet inside the envelope. It's got the instant load, so you can put half a card folded straight into it. There's also a version with a full card, where with the full card, and we'll put some clips on the screen as well, you've got this method of reaching into the wallet like this, and it looks like this, where you take out a full card. So there's lots of different things you can do with it. What's your initial thoughts, Wayne?
Well, I've been fortunate enough to see Andrew lecture this.
Right.
And he came out and he showed every single possibility that you can do with it. He spent a lot of time on it. And the one that I've just showed you, in my opinion, is my favourite.
I
really love that it's signed up, then it's in a sealed envelope. It feels even more impossible, like we just said earlier, that something's folded and then folded again. And not only that, it's like the ball of wool principle.
Yeah.
I love stuff like that.
The envelope, don't you?
I really
you
do.
You see, for me, I wouldn't use this as a working wallet, mainly because I use a bigger wallet.
Yeah.
One of those old-fashioned bigger wallets, mm-hmm. which I've used for years. And that routine is so ingrained in me, I can't change that now. But as an everyday wallet where you're just going out, I think this is really nice. I wouldn't bother with the envelopes. Mm. I would just use it as an envelope, you know, being able to put a folded card straight into it.
When Andrew did it, I must say, he had, it was like an ongoing experience. You know, the cards vanished from the packets, actually, in my wallet. Then he did that first one with the, it come out from, you know, from that peak. So he pushed, dropped it in there, pulled it out of there, put his wallet away, and instantly pulled it back out of there in another way. So it was like a progression, and then eventually it
was interesting.
Folded up. Yeah, so it had three, it was all about the wallet. I'm sorry, I don't know why that was there. Then, if I remember rightly, I'm sure that he left it on the table first of all, and I think it was a betcher. Might be, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm sure he put it on the table and
yeah,
said,
I bet. Yeah, because you can do a no palm.
That's what he
straight
did, yeah.
Into
he did,
it.
Yeah, sorry,
as you put
you've
the deck
jogged
up.
My memory. That's yeah. Exactly what he did. So that worked very well. There's lots of different things. He's obviously invested a lot of time, not just money on it, but a lot of time into it and constructed some very, very nice routines. That envelope being my favourite.
Yeah, so you've got between the cards, you've got a load straight in, you've got the load of a full card on the outside, you've got a mercury card or a hard folded card straight in, and you've got the peak as well.
Yeah.
So it does a lot, really. I would only use it as an everyday carry wallet. I would like it to hold bills a little bit more, but the quality of it is undeniable. I love that feature of being able to pop the card straight out. And it does so much. If you're looking for a casual, everyday carry wallet, I don't think you can go far wrong with this. It really does a lot for the money. I'm going to give it exactly 89%.
Are you? It's up to date. That's the thing. Yeah, because a lot of people are, you know, the wallets that that you and I, you know, we've done. It's that same thing.
How much can you give it, Wayne?
I'm also going to give it 89%.
89%.
It's 85% for me.
85%. It's a great looking wallet. It's not cheap, but you'd expect that from the quality. When you get it out, it does scream quality. Yeah. We had a close look at the stitching, didn't we, Wayne?
We did,
because we were concerned that it might fail after time, but no, it's actually made really, really well. It is a great quality wallet. And if you're in the market for an everyday carry wallet that does so much, you're not going to go far wrong with a Comet wallet from Andrew Dean. It's available from Andrew and all good magic shops. Next from Hiroshi Magic and Illusionist is Total Control. Paul,
hello.
Summarise the effect.
Total Control lets a magician take absolute control of his...
I like what you did there.
Thanks very much.
Absolute control.
Absolute control of someone else... No, of his own phone using someone else's phone. Or magic.
But it doesn't use apps.
It doesn't use apps. So you can show your phone to someone else, get them to explore it in any way they want. There is nothing running. Yet, when you use Total Control, you can play music from your phone. You can turn Bluetooth, Wi-Fi on and off. You can turn the brightness up and down. You can take photos. You know, literally, you could do anything you like using a myriad of methods.
Yeah, it looks like one phone, the spectator's phone, is controlling your phone.
Yeah.
Now, we will say up front, we would love to demonstrate this, but the fact that it uses music, we're a bit worried about it being muted on YouTube and on Facebook, but we will video a little routine, but look for that on our Instagram page. So have a look on the Instagram page and we will put the video up, and hopefully it won't be muted in most territories, so you'll actually be able to see a performance of it. It's a great thing. I showed it to Wayne this morning when I performed it on Wayne using his phone controlling mine. Wayne genuinely didn't know how it worked.
Honestly.
Because it is very deceptive. If somebody knows how an iPhone works, you can show them that, you know, if I open an app like the Photos, which is what I've done when I've performed it, you can show that you've got your Photos app open, and that's the only app, and you close it down, and there are no other apps running. At all, there are no apps. You can also show that in the corner of the control center, there's no music playing on the phones. There's no music at all.
But there's music playing.
But when you bring the two phones together, music starts to play. And then the cool thing is, when you bring it together for a second time, if you choose music that's the right sort of tempo, that actually provides backing music for the rest of the routine.
That's what I like.
And I've changed it. I've changed my music for the one that Roshi Magic uses, which is a little bit near the knuckle.
Yeah.
And a little bit, let's use the word modern.
I wouldn't choose it for me.
Yeah, it's not the right style of music for me. A bit sort of gangster. Rough sort of
gangster. Yeah.
But yeah, it suits his style. And along with this backing music, every time you touch one of the controls on the spectator's phone, it affects your phone. But the baffling thing is, you even turn the Bluetooth off during the routine.
Yeah.
And the Bluetooth goes off on your phone. So there is no way that this phone could be controlled at all. And yet, during the course of the routine,
it's still being controlled.
Hmm. It's a great part where you open up the camera and you actually reach down, and what I do, reach down where the button would be, push the button, you can record a bit of video or record a selfie. And all this is happening with yours and the spectator's phone. It is very, very clever. Now, I want to say it did take me a while to get through the tutorial. It's something like a 2-hour tutorial, isn't it?
Yeah, it must be.
Wow. It took me a while to get through it, and I kept having to stop it, pause it, and you have to work at it. I think I was working on it for about 4 hours until I'd got it to the point where I was like, okay, I'm right, I'm ready to start practicing it now. It's a good investment in time, and if you've not done anything like this before with programming an iPhone, I'm going to skirt around the methods slightly, but there's... You know, it's not as easy as just installing an app and just doing it.
No, it's not. But it is explained well.
Yeah,
in detail. But so it's just that initial, you have to set some time aside, give yourself an afternoon or a day, and then it's worth it.
Yeah.
Then it's worth it.
The way they explain it in the tutorial was very good. So I've got Geraint on the video, and he's kind of where you would start, Wayne, with no knowledge at all.
Okay, right.
And Hiroshi is teaching him how to do it. Mm-hmm. So over the course of the 2 hours, he shows G how to install it all on his phone, and you're kind of following along with that. But there are some points that you do have to pause it and go, hang on, let me get my head around that and go back again. Mm. That's what I did. Was that your experience?
Yeah, so I would describe myself as a very technical, but I don't have any Apple experience.
Yeah.
And there are some Apple elements in here that I didn't understand because I've just never used them. But once I got my head around them, for me, it was maybe slightly easier, but that's only because I come from a slightly more technical background. It's certainly within the reach, I think, of most people.
Yeah.
Once it's set up...
That's it.
That's it.
Yeah, you're ready to go.
That's good. In fact,
they said it's like memorizing a mem deck, right? So once you put that work in, you're good.
Yeah. And you can edit it afterwards, and you can change the choreography of the routine. Well, we will put clips on the screen, and you'll see the routine going on. It is fantastic to watch it performed. And I believe what G said on the tutorial as well, that whenever they were demoing it at this recent Magic convention, people would hear the music and come rushing over because they'd heard about this routine. It's very much like our Digit. It gives it a certain energy, the performance, because you've got the music playing. And unlike most Magic with mobile phones that tends to be mentalism based, it's very, very visual.
Yeah.
And that's what I like about it. And a lot of Hiroshi's effects, like I really like the call and invisible picture, which is a bonus on the call, which is a completely separate download. A lot of his effects, which I've started to look into, are so visual and so fun to perform. Mm. And that's something that's severely lacking in Magic with mobile phones. It really is normally only mentalism based.
I have two other things to add. The first is that the timing wise, it's up to you. So it doesn't play like a video. This is something that if something in the environment happens for the majority of this effect, you control when these things happen.
You're controlling it.
You are controlling it. Yeah.
You do need to get an extra thing, don't you?
But
it's very inexpensive, less than £5.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And the other thing to say is, It works on it works for the Spectator's phone being an Android as well as the Spectator's phone being an iPhone. So you can basically, as long as the Spectator's got
yours, needs to be an iPhone.
Yes, yours needs to be an iPhone.
Of course.
Unfortunate. Anyway, and the other thing to say is, if you do use two iPhones, it's quite likely, not like our digit, that people get confused whose phone is controlling whose.
Yes.
So,
what happened to you, Wayne?
That was a very good point. I couldn't remember after you had taken a video and photographs on whose phone it was on. I had to go back and check.
So for you, it was more incredible that I'd been controlling your phone at some point.
I mean, I do have to say, I do like the... I'm not a tech guy. I don't do tech magic. Not really into it. This, what you showed me today, actually did make me sit up. I like the choreography. That's what I liked about it. I'm a sleight of hand. That's the kind of magic I really like to do. Lovely bit of misdirection. But the choreography in this made me sit up and think, yeah, you know what? I would put effort in to learn it.
Right. Well, I am going to give this exactly 98%.
Of course you are.
98%?
98%, yes.
Okay, all day long. I'm going higher. I'm going higher. For me, it's 100%.
Go on.
I'll tell you why, because 100%, I'm absolutely going to use it. Plus, he's taught me the methods so that if I want to add my own little choreography or change it to what I need to do for my routine, I can 100% do that now. I think it's a fooler. I'm going to use it every gig. I love it.
Mm. Right, well, this is, you know, I'm not into it, but I loved what it was. So for me, it's 89%.
It's a great effect. And look out for the other releases from Hiroshi as well. He's got some great ideas, and it's always visual. It's always high energy. We're not quite all as high energy as Hiroshi when he's doing
his amazing.
He's magic. He's full of energy.
It's a battery.
In fact, I think he came up to me at Blackpool to perform Total Control, and I was absolutely shattered after a day on a dealer stand. He came up, "Hey, David, yeah, I'll show you that." And I was like, "What the hell's going on here?" I was a little bit stunned. And didn't really take in what was going on at the time. But it is fantastic, and I look forward to seeing more. It's a great release. Hopefully, we'll manage to get a performance on the Instagram page, because we're not going to risk it being muted on YouTube or on Facebook, because that does happen. We are going to try and do a dem of Route 66 by Magic Dream Paris. What is Route 66? Paul, can you tell us?
I can tell you that is the ultimate peak device.
Ultimate peak device. Let's try it out.
Ultimate. This is the final answer to peak devices, apparently.
It's a tag that you kind of have on your key ring here, so you can carry this tag with you always. Wayne, can I get you to write? Because if I got you to think of something, that thought only exists in your mind. Right?
Yeah, okay.
But let's cement that in more people's minds. Don't say it out loud. I want you to write it down on the tag just there. And I can even show the viewers. Probably won't be able to zoom in this far. But you can see we've got it on there. So a few people, you've seen that right now, Paul?
I have.
And I'm not looking, right?
Correct.
I'm not looking. What I'm going to do, I'm going to actually erase this.
Okay.
Tell me, has it gone?
Yes.
Yeah.
Has it gone?
Yeah.
But a moment ago, you all had that in your mind.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
You had that in your mind, so take that from me, Wayne. The only place this thought exists is actually inside your mind right now.
It is, yeah.
Did you think of a person, a place, or is it an object?
It's an object.
An object. Mm. This is something functional, isn't it?
Mm.
Yeah, okay. Did you think of a shoe?
I did.
Come on! Amazing!
You are having a laugh.
Peak device.
Ultimate.
And afterwards, you can take that and you can put it back on your key ring. It's your everyday carry peak device. There it is. Get rid of all the clipboards. Get rid of all the impression devices. You don't need it, because this is the ultimate peak device. What do you think to it, Paul?
I'm not sure it's the ultimate.
Really?
Peak device. I'll be honest. I watched the video and I kind of thought, well, I suppose...
The trailer or the tutorial?
The tutorial.
Tutorial,
And I thought, well, I suppose if you ever wanted something written small? And I was kind of justifying it, and then I saw it this morning, and I I'm not his biggest fan.
Because we got, I think we can probably get the footage. I did do it on somebody, didn't I? In the
yes, restaurant. You did. No, I didn't record it.
You didn't record
it? No, I didn't record it.
I thought you were recording
it. Yeah, so did I.
We did do it on the gentleman at the restaurant, the assistant manager, and he was taken aback. But
his reaction was amazing.
Yeah, he was genuinely impressed. So you've got to take that into account. We did go and actually perform it and see what kind of reaction it got. And to be, he wrote Car, didn't he? And
but to be fair,
got an amazing reaction.
To be fair, he would have given that reaction with any peak. I think. Yeah.
So do you think he was being considerate to the fact that it was the ultimate peak device?
No,
do you think he was even considering that?
What I'm saying was, he did give a great reaction. It was one of those step away, step back, hold his...
So?
But I think that was the effect of...
Can we talk about the functionality, what you get with it, Wayne, rather than just an opinion? What do you actually get with it, without giving away the secret?
Yeah, you kind of... What you see, really, is that saying, what you get. You need to carry around that pen. You got that with it as well.
A little bit of extra something, yeah.
There is a little bit of extra something that you will need to have on your person.
And to say you need to carry around this pen, it can be any dry white ball.
Yeah, just dry white marker.
Yeah, you get the ink on your finger at the end maybe as well.
Yeah.
But and it's like an hour-long tutorial. They do go through
They do go through some different types of handling. I do have an issue about calling it the ultimate. Don't call something an ultimate, because you're never going to bring out another Mark II version of something because you've just done the ultimate. That is it, ultimate.
I do like the fact. I like the fact that you can keep it on your keyring, and it seems impromptu, like you can wipe something off that was on there before, and then you get them to write something. But this is the EDC. This is quite nice as an EDC. But you know, then you've got to have this whiteboard pen. Now it's not an EDC. Mm-hmm. It's like you've got to have the pen with it as well.
Yeah. EDC's everyday carry. Right?
Yeah, I'm never going to use it. I think it's okay. I think even though they justify it in the tutorial by talking about a lecture they had with Ben Earl, and he talks about writing something down or taking a card after they thought of a card, and they only remember that they thought of a card, and they go through all this justification. It's very, very difficult to justify writing something down and then just immediately revealing
it. Which is my issue. That is my issue.
I don't know. I think it's very clever as a gimmick. I think it's really clever. Mm. If I'd have thought of it, would I have brought it out? I may have done, but I'd need to come up with a lot more justification, and a lot more... it would need to fit my working repertoire a lot more for me to release something like this. But it is a clever idea. But I don't want to say that, you know, it's a bad idea.
Well, this is why I say don't call it an ultimate, because for me, this... It feels like a working prototype. I think that's the best way.
Work in progress.
Yeah, it does.
It's like I know what you mean. It's like somebody's had an idea for a trick.
Yeah.
And they've gone, that's a good idea, but then it's not quite there.
Maybe this could be
it
made.
It feels like that. It's really weird.
This could be made better. All right, it is just a plastic tag and it's supposed to feel like that.
It does work though. I think that's a bit unfair. It does work.
Okay, yeah. No, it does do exactly what you're supposed to do. Again, the issue about writing something down and then immediately revealing it.
Which you don't have to do.
You can have that big pause between it. Yeah, I feel like there should be a Mark II version of this somewhere along the line.
I think the problem is, like you say, when you call something the ultimate, already you're as a reviewer, you're looking at going, here we go then, bring it on. And you kind of, it is detrimental when you call something ultimate, because you're expecting so much more. And yet it is only this. You know, this spellbinding, magical mind reading.
Exactly
that. You do.
Yeah.
I really like the stuff that Magic Dream put out. This is not one of my favourite releases. They've had some really great stuff recently, but I don't like this very much, actually. I don't see many pros or amateurs actually using it, carrying it. I'm not into it, sorry.
Yeah, it's
really... You might like it, but it's not for me. I'm going to give this like 45%. I don't like so many things about it.
So for me, it's quite small, so it doesn't play to a very big crowd. If you can think of a use and you would carry something like this, you've seen it performed, it works really well for what it does. If you can routine that, It's good. That's for you.
We haven't routined it.
Yeah, I can't at the moment, and I'm not sure I would, but that's just me. But you might find a use for it. So I'm going to go a bit higher. I'm going to go like 58.
Okay. Well, for me, like I say, the ultimate, they should have left that and just said, you know, brilliant peak device or something. Because that, for me, there's work to be done on it. It does work. It does do what it says it's going to do. But it just wasn't exciting enough. Mm. And for me, it's 52%.
52%. Yeah, it's... I keep saying it does work. I find it very difficult to give something a negative review because one man's trash is another person's treasure kind of thing. You might like it, but yeah, that's our opinion. Finally this week, from the creative mind of Angelo Carbone, he knows what he's doing, doesn't he?
He's a clever bloke.
He knows his stuff. We have got The End, which is his book test. And Wayne, we are going to demonstrate it, first of all.
Go on, mate.
I don't know if you've read this book. It's a bestseller by Tom Pearson, The Return of Tomorrow.
All right.
It is a genuine book. You can find it. It was in the bestseller, so have a look.
All right, mate.
Okay. And flick through. Make sure all the pages are all different. And how many pages are in that book?
There are... 325.
See, you're an intelligent guy, you see, Wayne. The other day I was doing a show, I think it was Milton Keynes, and I said to the guy, how many pages are in that book? And they opened it and they started going, 1, 2, 3. Wayne Smart, you see, straight to the end of the book.
I don't mess about.
Yeah, private school fees, didn't waste them.
No.
That's good. Open the book anywhere you like, Wayne. Go to any page, flick between the pages, go to any page you like.
All right, yeah.
And... hold the book up towards yourself, because I don't want you to think I've got hawk-like vision and can read the book from here.
Yeah.
I'm going to get you to look at either page, the left-hand page, the right-hand page. It's entirely up to you.
I've got it.
And I want you to look at an interesting word. So not a small word like if, at, on, why, how. It's got to be an interesting word, like a big word, more than 9 letters if you can. Have you got one?
I've got one. Yep.
Okay. What I want you to do... just visualise that word in your mind. Look at me. My God, you're attractive. That's good. Look at me.
I'll sit back.
And
get out of the way, Paul. Get out of the way, Paul.
Yeah. Keep the book up towards yourself, Wayne. So see the first letter here, and then imagine that you're reading the word like this.
Okay.
So first of all, look at the first letter. Don't say anything out loud.
No.
Okay, can we come back to that? We'll come back to that one. Okay, see the whole word, go right to the end of the word, right to the end, the last letter, okay? Think of the last letter.
Mm-hmm.
There's an R there, isn't there?
In the word, yeah.
No, the last letter is an R, right?
No.
No, you should, what's the last letter?
K.
K, this is really weird because this is the first letter, look at me, go right across to the end of the word. There's an R there, isn't there? There is an R right at the end of the word. Not the last letter, but close.
Right at the end, yeah.
So there is an R there?
Yeah, there is, yeah.
Okay, go back to the first letter here.
Yeah.
That's an S, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, you're just thinking of this word. Out of all the words you're thinking of, are you thinking of schoolwork?
Yes.
Yes.
That's great.
It's actually very, very clever. If you're familiar
it really
with
is clever.
Book tests. So why is this different? What justifies a release? Well, I've had book tests for years and things like I've used The Key by Terry Rogers, Flashback, all sorts of book tests. And the thing is, I never really thought about it before. You don't get an instructional video with it. You just get this booklet with it and you get a few extra bits that means there's no memory work at all.
That's the beauty.
Hopefully there that's clear. Is. There is no memory work at all with this. You can read the book. Paul's looking through it right now. It makes absolute sense when you read it. You just have to blag that it's a bestseller they've not seen ever. And The interesting thing, when you're using the original sort of mother of all book test principle, which I think was U.F. Grant, it is credited in here, you kind of have to fish for the first letter.
Yeah.
And quite often, even if you put that pressure on the spectator that's with you, so say you've picked a word, Wayne, I'd say to Paul, right, think of the first letter.
Mm-hmm.
He might get it right. But if he gets it wrong, you say, help him, what's the first letter? Mm-hmm. And it's not like you as a performer has made the mistake. But if you think about it, and I never really thought about this before until Angelo brings it up in the instructions, it is feasible that if you've read a book and you're quite good at memory work and you've asked them to pick a big interesting word, it's quite feasible that if you know the first letter, you could have an intelligent guess.
Right.
The great thing with the end is that there is no perceived fishing and everything seems like a hit. You may have uncomfortable silences and pauses during the routine while you're doing the perceived mind reading, but that's okay,
yeah,
right?
It's not a problem.
You're reading somebody's mind.
Yeah, it's all right.
Yeah, it's okay because you're going, okay, I'll come back to the first letter. Then you're telling them there's an R at the end of the word. There is an R at the end of the word. That's always a hit. Absolutely always a hit. So you're not failing even when you ask for the first letter, which then will give you the information that you need to continue with your mind reading experiment and reveal that whole world. And there is no memory work as well. As long as you've got your pen ready to write things down, you don't need any memory work at all.
That's what sold it to me when I've spoken to Angelo about it, and when he said about that, no memory work, it was just, hang on a minute then, brilliant. Because it just looks like an incredible, as magicians looking at it, you're thinking they're reverse engineering everything in their head, they're talking about, you're not, there's no memory work.
Yeah, there is no fishing as far as the spectator's concerned. You're never asking for information because it seems like you're just telling them what the last letter is.
Exactly.
It seems like you're telling them what the first letter is and everything gets a little bit muddled, and it's because you're using the same principle but at the end of the word.
Yeah.
But it's even better than that because the R is always a hit.
Mm.
So you can do memory work if you want.
Yeah.
You don't have to, if you don't want to have to carry that extra thing around, you absolutely can do the memory work. The other thing I'll say is this book reads brilliantly. I mean, there's no way I'm reading this and it's a gimmicked book of any sort. It is brilliant. Nothing else to say. Angelo, I don't know how Angelo thinks. I don't know the way Angelo's brain works differently to mine, and I thank him for it.
Mother of all book tests, one of the best principles ever in magic.
Yeah.
Ever. This is better.
Yeah,
it's better. It's more deceptive. So if you're in the market for a book test, I would suggest don't just do one thing. Don't just do one book test. You know, there's so much more you could do. I always think rule of three, you know, get a flashback involved as well and just name a word, then have somebody think of a word. Then maybe do a dictionary test afterwards. Don't just do one thing. But this could easily be the strongest part of a book test routine if you've got a few books involved and you're handing out books to members of the audience. It's absolutely impossible. I didn't think I was going to go back and do a book test ever again because I enjoyed doing so many digital things. But I really like this. I think it's brilliant. I've already got the master key, which I use in my act.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to change the master key over to this part in that routine.
Wow.
I'm still going to do flashback. I'm still going to do the dictionary test at the end. But the bit in the middle is normally the master key,
mm-hmm.
where you have to get a spectator to make a mistake and fish for that first letter. There's no fishing. So straight away, the method's just got better. I have to use, I'm giving this 100%. It's brilliant.
I have to say something as well, where you just said there's no fishing. What I'm going to point out...
Perception.
Yeah. You're not asking, you're telling.
Yeah.
That's how it's working. You're not asking them, you are telling them. And that is a huge, massive, massive difference, which makes it the most powerful piece of book test mind reading I've ever seen.
If you're already using the UF Grant principle, I believe this is stronger.
Yeah.
it's stronger in the spectator's mind because there's no perceived fishing. Everything's,
I mean, you are looking
hit.
Anywhere in the book, for goodness sake. You're choosing where to go and that's it. So for me as well, it is. I'm giving it 100%.
Paul, is it your thing?
Are you kidding? So in case you think this might be too difficult for you, that's the instructions. There's no video instructions. That's it.
Made, yeah.
That's it. Right, and it's that simple. It looks that good every time.
Every time.
Why aren't you getting it? Why wouldn't you do this?
If
you
really wanted
any sort of book test, any sort of mind reading, why wouldn't you do this?
He's a bloody creative genius.
Yeah,
I hate him.
I love him. And 100% from me, definitely.
Yeah, it's one of those things where you think, how does anybody go, mother of all book tests, there's a better way of doing it, surely? How do you start with that?
Well, he has literally sat down somewhere and gone, hang on a minute.
Sat in a coffee shop for 20 minutes going, I know.
That's how you do it.
Amazing. The book looks great as well.
Yeah,
it's 100% credible. It looks fantastic. You would have no problem handing this to a spectator.
You know what I would do
it
as well?
Like a story.
You need, like all my props, what I like to do, which you hate me doing,
scuff it up a bit.
Age it up a little bit. Yeah, make sure it looks like it's
dirty it up. 300% is the highest mark this week on the Wizard Magic Review.
Well done, Angelo.
Yeah, good man.
Congratulations, Angelo Carbone. MIMC with Gold Star.
He is.
It's quite a select club, isn't it?
It really is.
Until next week, I'm Dave.
I'm Paul.
I'm Wayne.
We'll see you next time on the Wizard Magic Review.